Oh, good evening, colleagues, and welcome once more to a weekly webinar. I see quite a number of people logged in quite early today. And I just want to welcome you, so Raymond Biela speaking, to our weekly webinar hosted by Clinics Health Group. We normally play our video clip for showcasing one of the hospitals within the group, but unfortunately tonight we are not able to do so, as we have run into some problems with one of our gadgets for showing that. And also we are not able to record on YouTube immediately, but we'll download the recording later on YouTube, not tonight, but tomorrow morning. And so we just want to welcome you, colleagues, to our weekly webinars. And it's exciting that you are always joining us every week since we started sharing this moment with you, bringing in quite a number of speakers from various disciplines across the health field, different health disciplines, primarily the medical disciplines. And so this is one of those evenings that we do that once more. Last week, I indicated that we'll be discussing that we spend this month discussing diabetes, or most of the presentations, but we had confirmed the speaker for tonight, but unfortunately that didn't work out. We got a late cancellation, but we're so fortunate that when we picked up the phone and called Professor Sarada Naika, she was kind enough to avail herself. And Professor Naika has also had to, he had other engagements, but because she had committed to speaking to us, she humbly, and also that we're saying this, that she gracefully accepted the invitation to speak to us. So as usual, this is a CPD accredited webinar, and we hope that you've submitted when you registered, you sent us your details. I just discovered that some colleagues who are logging in every week, but they are receiving their invitations via WhatsApp and not email, and they have not provided us with their email addresses. Please do send us your email address so that we put you in our database, if you're okay with that, so that when you send out invitations, you also receive the invitations to these webinars. Because when you get your details, CPD, registration numbers with HPCSA or SANC or pharmacy, whatever society, the registration body, regulation body that you are registered with, we send this to them. For those with the HPCSA, you don't have to do anything. Once you're registered, your information will be uploaded, goes to HPCSA, and you get your CPD points. And so this evening, we excited to have a Professor Sarada Naika, who's well known to most of us in the country as one of the top specialist physicians and nephrologists in the country, was a graduate from the University of Natal, of course, Natal, as it is called now, has a PhD, also the fellow of the College of Physicians. And she's also a professor emeritus of medicine and the chair of the Graduate Studies and Research of the School of Clinical Medicine at the University of the Witwatersrand. She's held a position as the academic head at Wits and also head of a division of nephrology, also president of the South African Renal Society, and also president of the South African Transplantation Society, and also chaired the South African Ministerial Advisory Committee for Transplantation, amongst a number of other responsibilities. And also she is part of the international program that Society of Nephrology for several years, the executive committee, and also part of the scientific committees that she teaches there. And so at the moment, she is also working with a number of students who are doing their masters and PhDs. And so she's the supervisor for all of this, quite a number, I think more than 50, which is quite a lot. And so we have an authority this evening, and she'll be speaking to us on the management of chronic kidney disease with a special focus on prevention of progression. And so Professor Sarada Naika, we're quite excited to have you this evening, and thank you for honoring the invitation to speak to us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bila, for the very kind invitation and for the very kind introduction as well. And I'm really pleased that I was able to join you, even though it was an error, but you know, errors have to be honored. So
yes.
So as I said, so I'm really pleased to be with you, and I'll be very happy to take any questions afterwards. Sure. I must start by saying that I have no disclosures, have no links with anybody, so I've got no conflicts of interest. And to start, I must recall a story. When I was the organizer of the first African nephrology meeting in South Africa, one of our guest speakers was Secretary for Health. And then he said to us that all of us are failures because we are having so many people who need dialysis. So I think this talks to that comment of his. I mean, we were, of course, very incensed and upset with him for making that comment. But I think he was quite correct that all of us need to spend more time, pay more attention to trying and preventing kidney failure, both acute and chronic. But because that's such a vast topic, I'm just going to confine myself to chronic kidney disease today and what we could do to try and prevent its progression to end-stage kidney failure. So this is a brief outline of what I'm going to talk about. I think it's very important for us to know about the major risk factors and what we should be doing about them, and to see if we could impact on the progression of kidney disease. So basically, that's what will be covered by this outline. A brief case presentation which is bread and butter for all physicians, either family practitioners, specialist physicians, nephrologists. In this, you see, this is a relatively young man, 52 years old, Black. And I think both the male gender and the race are important. As you see, he's got hypertension with a blood pressure of 170 over 108, has evidence cardiologically that he's got target organ damage and 2+ protein on urine dipsticks. And if you look at the investigations, you can see that his serum creatinine is elevated, as is the blood urea. The random blood glucose is reasonable. And the other important investigations are evidence of proteinuria, 1.4 grams. And on ultrasound, the kidneys slightly decreased in size with increased echogenicity, and the ECG confirmed left ventricular hypertrophy and strain. And then to look at the bottom, you could see that once the kidney function level was established, looking at the CKD epi, which is the currently recommended calculation, you could see that his GFR is just under 50, and the MDRD equation was used, it's just over 50. Now, one of the things we do know is that the GFR equation depends on the measurement of serum creatinine, which could be quite fallible. And therefore, these estimated GFRs are not always that accurate. And if you do need a very accurate GFR, for instance, if somebody is going to be a kidney donor, then you need to have a more accurate measurement, like an isotope measurement with technetium or DTPA, iodothalamate. So just to try and ensure that you have an accurate GFR. But for general purposes and for us working in the clinics, this calculation gives you a very good working estimate of where the kidney function is. So before we proceed much further, I think we need to know what are the criteria to establish a diagnosis of chronic kidney disease. And the important criterion presented by KDIGO, which is an important guidelines committee for kidney disease, is that evidence, there has to be evidence of abnormalities of structure or function for at least 3 months. So that means you cannot find an abnormal serum creatinine today and decide the person has chronic kidney disease unless there's other evidence that's very compelling. And the markers of kidney damage are albuminuria, and you find that the urine sediment is abnormal, presence of red cells or protein, also electrolyte or tubular disorders, or if the person had a biopsy and the biopsy shows evidence of kidney damage histologically, or on imaging there are structural abnormalities, and if the person has a history of prior kidney transplantation. So all these equate to chronic kidney disease. And of course, the figure for the level of kidney function for chronic kidney disease is an eGFR of less than 60 mLs per minute. Now, why is kidney function important? There's major risks for mortality and morbidity in people who could be asymptomatic. And it's proposed that a lot of people are dying undiagnosed of kidney disease, undiagnosed with kidney disease. They're dying of something else. And the recent Global Burden of Disease study listed the various conditions that are associated with mortality worldwide for all conditions. And you could see hypertension is the top risk. Problems with the glycemic control, obesity, hyperlipidemia, and kidney function is right there at number 9. And looking at what happens, what's the association for morbidity and mortality with decreased kidney function? So if we take a level of above 60 as a baseline, and you could see as one goes down to further decrements in kidney function, one could see that the hazard ratio exponentially increases. And once the GFR is less than 15 mLs per minute, end-stage kidney disease, you could see that the hazard ratio is almost sixfold increased compared to those with a GFR of above 60. And cardiovascular events, there's almost a 3.5-fold increase in people with severe kidney disease, and also the risk of hospitalization increases. So from this, what's known by nephrologists and other physicians is that most people with chronic kidney disease die prematurely from their increased risk of cardiovascular disease before they even develop end-stage kidney failure. And therefore, we need to impact on this to try and prevent people from dying of heart disease because of their kidney disease. And looking at the burden of non-communicable diseases, one could see again in this global burden of disease study that cardiovascular diseases are very important, chronic respiratory disease, and then diabetes and kidney disease follow on hand in hand. And looking at the global chronic kidney disease prevalence, 5 years ago, it was estimated that there were over 850 million people with chronic kidney disease. And this equates, and this was made up by men constituting 10.4% and women 11.8%. And looking at the different stages, this prevalence more recently in 2020 was estimated to be 9.1% overall. And as you see, stage 1 to 2, this is where the highest prevalence is at 5%. Stage 3, just under 4%. And interestingly, when one gets to stage 5, it's only 0.07%, of which 0.04 are on dialysis and 0.01 have been transplanted. So you can see there's a huge mismatch of figures. Firstly, a lot of people obviously don't get to stage 5, and it doesn't mean that we don't know whether they are stable at stage 3 or stage 4. We need longitudinal studies to see that. And once they get to stage 5, you could see the availability of renal replacement therapy is not huge for costs and other reasons. And looking at the prevalence in Africa, this meta-analysis published recently, looking at 98 studies in Africa, computed that the overall prevalence stages 1 to 5 was 15.8, and stages 3 to 5, the chronic kidney disease stages, were 4.6%. And interestingly, if you look at the different regions, North Africa, just over 6%, West Africa, 19.8%, Southern Africa, 10.4%, and East Africa, 14.4%. But obviously, the meta-analysis depends on the quality of the studies that were looked at. And looking at some more recent studies that were done at WITS, the recent study that we had published in the Lancet Global Health, looking at sub-Saharan countries in South Africa, East Africa, that is Kenya, and Burkina Faso, one could see that the prevalence of chronic kidney disease in this study was 10.7%, very similar to the meta-analysis that I showed you. And then interestingly, that the prevalence was highest in South Africa compared to West Africa, unlike that meta-analysis that I showed you, 14% in the South African study versus 6.6% in West Africa. And women had a higher prevalence at 12% compared to men at 9.5%. And the risk factors for kidney damage in this study were older age, hypertension, almost a twofold increased risk, diabetes, more than a twofold increased risk, and HIV. So it's not surprising that the common conditions that we treat every day are risk factors for kidney damage. And more recently, we looked at the top panel. The data I showed you were the bottom panel from the OHN study. The more recent study, the ARC study, where again, June Fabian is the lead author of this paper, looking at South Africa, Malawi and Uganda, Malawi, South Africa and Uganda. And you could see that the imputed levels of chronic kidney disease, again, are the highest in South Africa and the lowest in Uganda at just under 7%. Now, looking at gender, as previous data shows, that CKD prevalence has increased in women, and this global burden of disease study estimated it at 9.5% in women and 7.3% in men. But interestingly, once you look at people receiving dialysis and transplantation, the prevalence is higher in men at 13.7, a 4.7-fold increase compared to women, where it was 8.6%. And again, many reasons for this, and it's not absolutely clear. One of the reasons could be that men are able to access dialysis and transplantation in many parts of the world more easily than women. And then looking at age, as mentioned, 8 to 10% of people suffer from chronic kidney disease globally. But as one reaches the 70s, this increases to 35%. So older age is certainly associated with the higher prevalence of chronic kidney disease. But that holds globally and in high-income country, whereas in poorer countries, looking at sub-Saharan Africa, chronic kidney disease affects mainly young adults, and the peak ages are between 20 and 50, and primarily due to hypertension and glomerular diseases. In India, again, around same age, China, and also studies in the US have shown that African Americans have greater rates of hypertension related end-stage kidney disease, which also have a genetic predisposition We'll talk about that shortly. I don't want you to look at this very busy slide, except to look at big topics under the clinical, sociodemographic, and genetics. So as mentioned, diabetes, hypertension, the top causes of top risks for chronic kidney disease, and infections, various infections depending on where one is, HIV, hepatitis B, hepatitis C. Avoidable causes, nephrotoxic medication that one needs to think about, and then a whole host of other risks associated. For instance, smoking is very interesting in that in people with diabetes and diabetic nephropathy, smokers have been shown to progress more rapidly to chronic kidney disease, have proteinuria occurring earlier, and kidney failure progressing more rapidly. And as mentioned, age, older age, non-white race, and poor socioeconomic situations are associated with risks for chronic kidney disease. An important genetic risk in Black population is the APOL1 risk alleles. This has been found to be very significant in HIV kidney disease and has also been shown to be associated with the hypertensive kidney disease, but to a lesser extent, as well as sickle cell disease and the other genetic diseases there. Probably the commonest kidney disease, commonest genetic disease is polycystic kidney disease, which causes chronic kidney disease and end-stage kidney disease. This global study that we're all involved in a few years ago, published in The Lancet in 2013, still very highly cited, looking at chronic kidney disease, global dimensions, risks, et cetera. So if you look at it going from the top to the bottom, you could see that worldwide diabetes is very important. And the green is hypertension as well. South Africa, you could see at that stage with diabetes was not recognized as such a huge problem, but we find with time an increasing epidemic of obesity and diabetes, these figures have now changed, but hypertension and glomerular diseases were very important here. And looking at a recent American database, their renal database, the most recent one, again, to point out risks of diabetes, it's important to see that it's there at all age groups from a young age, becomes more prevalent at a higher age, past the ages of 60 onwards. And then if you look at hypertension, again, increases in frequency as people age. And then looking at glomerular disease, very important in younger age groups and not so important as people get older. And then to try and quantify these, the global burden of study and our colleague from Africa, Dr. Ekripo, between them, they quantified that diabetes constitutes just over 30% of chronic kidney disease, and it's also associated with over 50% of those with impaired fasting glucose. Hypertension, 43%, high BMI, 26%. And if you're looking at prevalence, population prevalence, you could see that about 6.4% of people who are HIV positive may end up with chronic kidney disease. And the important thing, I like quoting this very old paper because things haven't really changed. And I'll show you another global burden of disease study that bursts this out. You could see that the global prevalence was reported as 26% in 2000. And the figures for the various countries, India 37, China 21, Sub-Saharan Africa 27 and 28%. And as we speak, the numbers are increasing, but important to know that control of hypertension, something that we all spend a lot of time and energy treating, is very poor. You could see that globally, the control is very poor, both in developed and developing countries. And in South Africa, this old study by Chrysalis Steyn showed the prevalence of 21%, with less than 50% were treated and less than a third were controlled. So again, there's lots we can do to impact on these figures. And looking at HIV, the epicenter, as we all know, is Sub-Saharan Africa and South Africa, Southern Africa in particular. And chronic kidney disease has been reported in about 10% of African Americans and about 6 to 45% in Sub-Saharan Africa. Again, this depends on the type of study. Our population-based studies show that the population prevalence, the prevalence of chronic kidney disease is about 6 to 8% in the different provinces of South Africa. And there's a genetic predisposition for the worst form of chronic kidney disease, which is HIV-associated nephropathy. This is APOL1 risk, high-risk alleles. In the US, the association was an odds ratio of 29. In our study in Johannesburg, this was the highest odds ratio ever reported, where we found that our odds ratio for HIVAN was 89 in Johannesburg. And looking at relationships of proteinuria and decline in kidney function, when you look at the lowest levels of urinary protein, a mean of 1.39 versus just over 3 grams, and a high level of proteinuria over 6 grams. And you can see how the GFR declines monthly, starting with a low level. And you can see that the decline is almost 20-fold at very high levels of proteinuria. And therefore, physicians and nephrologists spend a lot of time and effort trying to reduce proteinuria in people. And what about alternative medicines? As I mentioned, medications are very important, both prescribed medications in the form of non-steroidal anti-inflammatories and other medications, but also there's a whole lot of other medications. And there are pockets worldwide, India, Sri Lanka, China, Africa, Latin America, where they've reported a chronic kidney disease of unknown origin, or CKDU, and they're not absolutely sure how much is related to chronic kidney disease, how much is related to traditional medicines. And in fact, in low-income countries, poor people tend to use traditional medicine as a principal form of healthcare. And looking at risk factors, herbs, we know that there are nephrotoxic herbs widely used in Africa and Asia. And whilst often many of these herbs may not be nephrotoxic themselves, while some may be, like Impila, Imbiza, etc., a lot of them may be contaminated by other substances like mercury, copper, etc. And these interact and result in nephrotoxic toxicity. In Belgium, chronic kidney disease, finally, after a lot of investigative nephrology, was identified as due to aristolochic acid. These were people attending slimming clinics in Belgium, young women, and they were all taking herbal medication, thinking this was very good, and they were gradually going into kidney failure. And their kidneys just showed interstitial damage, and nobody could work out what it was until somebody went along and analyzed their herbal medication and discovered that they had, that it was a major constituent for aristolochic acid. Now, looking at the CKDU issue that I mentioned, Sri Lankan and Indian farmers have been reported to have this condition, as well as sugarcane farmers in El Salvador. And they think there's some heavy metal contamination or unidentified toxin. And this is a current investigation to see what's causing these young males, and generally men, to go into silently and insidiously develop chronic kidney disease. at a young age. Now, I was alluding to how well we achieve treatment targets. And this global burden of disease study published recently in The Lancet last year. I'm just going to look at a couple of things. Looking at diabetes, for instance, when you look at 100 patients with diabetes, one could see that only just over 63% are screened, 44% are diagnosed, 38% are treated, and only 23% are controlled. So almost similar numbers for hypertension, but shockingly in this study, only 10% had their blood pressures controlled. And when you're looking at HIV, one could see again, we're not really achieving our treatment targets for HIV in that just about 32% are controlled. HIV is under control. So quite often we very vigorously, when patients are referred to us with chronic kidney disease, with hypertension and proteinuria, you're not sure if the hypertension predated the kidney disease or not. And sometimes it's inexorable, even though at a late stage when you do control blood pressure, you cannot totally prevent the progression to end-stage kidney disease, though you can certainly delay the progression. And when you look at whatever the condition is that causes reduction in kidney or nephron mass, what happens is that the glomeruli undergo hyperfiltration and oxidant damage with proteinuria, which is underpinned by various cytokines and chemokines, with activation of NF-kappa B, overexpression of growth-promoting factors and fibrogenic agents like TGF-beta, FGF, various other issues, and infiltration of various inflammatory cells, macrophages and lymphocytes. And the end result of all these factors is glomeruli becomes sclerosed, and the tubuli also become atrophic and dilated and don't function properly. And when one biopsies patients at this stage, one just finds very sclerotic kidney, which is where the glomeruli are fibrosed and the tubular interstitial structure is also fibrosed. So when one finds people with chronic kidney disease, one needs to address the risk factors for chronic kidney disease to try and prevent the chronic kidney disease if you can pick the patient up early enough. So when one diagnoses hypertension or diabetes, it's important to assess the level of kidney function and follow the patient up regularly to ensure that they don't develop any chronic disease like kidney disease or heart disease. And once a person develops chronic kidney disease, at this stage, one endeavors to slow the progression and to prevent complications, which we'll discuss later. And once end-stage kidney disease is reached, one looks at how to treat these patients with dialysis in the form of hemodialysis or peritoneal dialysis or transplantation. But a large proportion of the world, especially in low, middle income and low income countries, are not able to access dialysis. And one needs to look at comprehensive conservative care, which means that one needs to address the symptoms and keep people comfortable. I'm just showing this to you, just to show you where we are in our treatment. In 2018, this global database showed that in South Africa, we're treating 181 per million of the population, compared to Taiwan, just treating over 3,000 per million of the population, Japan and the US over 2,000. Obviously, a lot of it depends on economic factors, and seeing that low-income countries are not able to to provide renal replacement therapy. So we need to try and prevent our patients from needing renal replacement therapy. So therefore, our kidney disease prevention program is a solution. So that's what we need to look at, how we can prevent this. Firstly, who should be screened? So while in an ideal world, one should screen everybody for everything, but it's not practical, either logistically or economically. So therefore, one needs to look at the at-risk population, those with hypertension, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, family history of chronic kidney disease, HIV, and those with previous history of acute kidney failure, because it's been shown that while people might recover from acute kidney injury, the recovery may not be total. So therefore, people who've had a previous history need to be followed up, and one needs to ensure that they do not progress to chronic kidney disease. And how does one screen? So basically, one should look at serum creatinine and EGFR, and one needs to do urinalysis to detect presence of proteinuria and hematuria. And then optimally, one should have imaging studies like ultrasound. Now, a lot of times people do appear at clinics, have bloods taken. Bloods don't often get to the laboratory, or patients do not return for results. So what would be ideal in our present world is to have point of care measurements of serum creatinine to ensure that we detect them, the kidney disease, when the patient is there at the clinic seeing their healthcare professional. Now, when you look at prevention, one needs to look at three stages of prevention. Primary prevention, where one looks at preventing CKD risk factors and also treating CKD risk factors. So this is health promotion. And I think South Africa is trying to do this by trying to cut down salt in food, sugar in food, trying to stop smoking. And globally, WHO is advocating health promotion and also trying to impact on the epidemic of obesity that we have. Now, secondly, prevention begins at the diagnosis of CKD, where the GFR initially above 60. One needs to attend to guidelines for good management of risk factors, and one needs to educate the patient as to the importance of following up treatment. It's amazing how often that one would see a patient with end-stage kidney failure who may have been diagnosed with hypertension or diabetes 10 or 15 years ago, but for some reason did not realize that treatment for these conditions is lifelong. And therefore, that needs to be addressed. And also, one shouldn't have stockouts. So common drugs should be available at primary health clinics so people don't run out of medication. And then when one reaches stage 3 and stage 4, one needs to try and address the complications of CKD, such as anemia, and then educate patient about end-stage kidney disease choices. And if hemodialysis is going to be instituted, one needs to implement things like vascular access at an earlier stage. And then finally, one needs to look at adequate kidney replacement therapy. So the principles of management, as mentioned, are the early identification of chronic kidney disease. Therefore, all people with the risk for chronic kidney disease should have kidney function measured. And one needs to estimate the severity of the chronic kidney disease. What is the glomerular filtration rate? And if possible, important to know what the cause is, because if you know the cause, you might have some opportunity to prevent further progression. And therefore, to make a specific renal diagnosis, if it's at all possible, and also to assess how stable the kidney function is. Is the kidney function deteriorating rapidly, or is it a relatively stable kidney function? And therefore, one needs to detect and correct any reversible cause. for instance, to make sure diabetes and hypertension are well controlled. If people are on nephrotoxic drugs, these need to be stopped. One could try and reduce proteinuria with various agents. And then to avoid additional renal injury, for instance, try and avoid contrast media investigations, if at all possible. May not always be possible, but to try and avoid, and to try and use antibiotics and medications that are not nephrotoxic. May not always be possible to avoid it, but as far as possible, one should avoid it. And to identify comorbidities like heart disease, vascular disease, and address these. And then institute interventions to delay progression, and we'll discuss these further, and to try and prevent complications like anemia, malnutrition, hyperparathyroidism, because these in themselves can promote progression of chronic kidney disease, and then to plan for kidney replacement therapy at a later stage. I think we've more or less discussed all this, and the important thing is to assess how stable kidney function is and what's the stage of CKD that the patient is in. This very busy slide, just to look at the common complications of people with chronic kidney disease, for instance, anemia. So one tries to rule out other causes of anemia like iron, B12 deficiency, bleeding, etc., and not assume that the anemia is just due to chronic kidney disease, due to relative erythropoietin unavailability. And then to measure, to look at whether the patient has mineral and bone disorders and measure the serum calcium phosphate and parathyroid hormone if possible, because if one can correct these, this would also help in delaying progression of chronic kidney disease. Hyperkalemia can be an important problem as kidney failure or kidney dysfunction progresses. So at that stage, if this is present, one needs to avoid drugs that are potassium sparing and also to correct acidemia and to advise people on low potassium diets. Also metabolic acidosis. Many patients have metabolic acidosis, and one could give oral bicarbonate supplementation. And as mentioned, cardiovascular disease, to try and treat with low-dose statins if this is present. Now, looking at other renal protective strategies and what are the targets, glycemic control, one should try and maintain the hemoglobin A1C at less than 7%. Looking at blood pressure control, very tight blood pressure control, less than 130 over 80. And it's suggested that one should try and get it to at least 125 over 75 if a proteinuria of more than a gram per day is present. And one tries and specifically uses renin-angiotensin blockade, both as antiproteinuric agent and in themselves are found to be renal protective. So ACE inhibition, angiotensin receptor blockers, aldosterone antagonists, and recently the SGLT2 inhibitors are also found to be renal protective in both diabetics and non-diabetics. Other measures to limit dietary salt to 3 to 5 grams a day, limit saturated fats, very important to stop smoking, try and lower lipids, and exercise 30 minutes a day, weight control, and antiplatelet therapy are all suggested as part of the armamentarium. And this very busy slide, I think there've been a lot of webinars recently on the SGLT2 inhibitors. And while it's been shown to be cardioprotective, the various agents have been shown initially to be protective in diabetic kidney disease, and studies now are looking at the recent study of heart and kidney protection, recruiting patients with type 2 diabetes and chronic kidney disease, and non-diabetic patients with chronic kidney disease, because of the suggestion that these agents are renal protective. Excuse me. Of course, affordability is always an issue, but we can hope that with increased use, we will also have access to these agents. Now, looking at various prevention strategies, one, it's important to individualize treatment, even though one does recommend protocolizing treatment, especially at primary healthcare level, to try and ensure that maximum number of people are treated. So therefore, one needs to try and adhere to targets for blood pressures and looking at angiotensin receptor blockade. Important to be aware that with more advanced stages of, a lot of people are nervous about using these agents because of the risk of hyperkalemia, but it's recommended that one should check the serum potassium 2 to 4 weeks after instituting ACE inhibition in people with chronic kidney disease, and only withdrawing it if hyperkalemia is a significant issue. And also in children, one needs to be careful because it's been shown that there's a high level of elevated blood pressure in children, and therefore one needs to try and get this blood pressure down to the 50th percentile for age, gender, and height. And what about proteinuria? Firstly, one needs to try and prevent the risk of acute kidney injury. And therefore, if your patient with chronic kidney disease is on an ACE inhibitor for whatever reason and has an intercurrent illness such as influenza or diarrheal illness or something that makes them dehydrated, so it's important for them to stop these agents short term so that they do not go into acute on chronic kidney failure because of catastrophic drops in blood pressure. And looking at protein intake, while the level of evidence is not very strong, it's recommended that once patients reach stage 4 to 5 CKD, one should reduce the protein intake to 0.8 of a gram per kilo per day. But it's important and not to ensure that patients don't become malnourished. Already mentioned glycemic target of around 7%, salt restriction to 3 to 5 grams per day. And one also needs to institute this in children. And then lifestyle, physical activity, 30 minutes, 5 times a day, a healthy weight, stop smoking. And then one needs to give patients expert dietary advice, preferably with a renal dietitian, and their diet can be tailored to the level severity of kidney failure. So when does one refer to nephrology? Initially, anybody who was diagnosed as chronic kidney disease, that's a GFR of below 60, was referred to a nephrologist. But these patients can be very well looked after by their physicians and primary care doctors. So the recommendation is that they should be referred to nephrology care if the GFR is less than 30 mLs per minute or decreasing very rapidly, which is more than 3 mLs per minute per year. If they've got significant proteinuria, if the blood pressure is difficult to control, or if they have hematuria or proteinuria or other evidence of a secondary disease like glomerular disease, then these patients may need other therapy like a kidney biopsy and immunosuppression. So early nephrology referral has some benefits, where patient education regarding options, how to, and also how to plan the treatment One could also institute preemptive transplantation before they need dialysis, and one could work them up in a timely fashion and institute and place an arteriovenous fistula in those who are opting for future hemodialysis. And value of education, primary care physicians will be better able to meet the goals of treatment in high-risk patients, and patients, once they understand what risk factors mean and how important it's to treat to target, then hopefully one can have better adherence to lifestyle goals and improvements in health. And then hopefully one does result in slower progression, improved functional status, and decreased morbidity and mortality from hospitalizations, cardiovascular events, better management of medication, and urgent and emergency visits. So fewer emergency complications and what we call crash landers, where the mortality for those needing urgent dialysis is high. So we can, by regular follow-up, one could decrease these, decrease costs, and decrease mortality. And we know that Africa has one of the lowest numbers of healthcare workers globally, 2.3 per 10%, compared to the US at almost 25. And looking at nephrology numbers, very low numbers in sub-Saharan Africa, 0.5 per million of the population. South Africa, we are 2 per million of the population, compared to over 26 in high-income countries. The interest of time, I won't go through these figures, which list the number of nephrologists in different countries. What's important is that because we don't have so many physicians, so many nephrologists, and also patients are being placed in undue hardship, attending different clinics for HIV, clinics for TB, clinics for diabetes, clinics for hypertension, clinics for their heart condition. So one should really have a chronic disease clinic where patients can have one-stop care for all the issues addressed, the blood pressure, the diabetes control, blah, blah, the advice to stop smoking. So I think that's the way we should be doing this, for efficient management, both from the perspective of the healthcare worker and from the patients. We know that our patients are getting poorer, and traveling to access care costs them a lot. And it's understandable why patients don't often attend their clinics as frequently or as regularly as they should be. And then also, knowing that in Africa, we have such a low number of physicians, task sharing is very important. So one needs to look at non-physician clinicians, such as clinical assistants, nursing assistants, et cetera. And one can train nurses to follow protocols very easily. In fact, they're better than medical practitioners in adhering to protocols. So nursing assistants and community health workers can easily manage a lot of chronic diseases. And they need training to know when to refer patients, and they need to be supervised by doctors and specialists. And this project from WHO is something that's happening in some countries to good effect. And looking at what are the requirements for a chronic kidney disease, or I'd like to call it a non-communicable disease prevention clinic, is one needs to ensure sustainability by having trained staff at all levels, including community health workers, availability of diagnostic materials, including point of care, availability of key medications at all times, and education for primary and secondary prevention. This is where we have the opportunity to prevent kidney disease, to the healthcare worker to focus on achieving treatment targets, patients who need to be aware of treatment targets and to take charge of their health. And then, as I mentioned, availability of diagnostic material and especially point of care testing. And one needs to ensure that results at bay when the patient's there seeing their healthcare worker, and ensure that there are appropriate referral pathways so that patients don't get lost in the system trying to access specialists and other care. So in conclusion, chronic kidney disease burden is high, and it's important that one has reliable data so that one can advocate for care of non-communicable disease. And therefore, one needs registries to inform the burden of disease and outcomes to funders and to governments so that adequate funding is allocated to patients. And as I've mentioned, access to diagnostics is very, very important. You'll be surprised at how many regions are unable to do a reliable or accurate serum creatinine, for instance. And then one needs to be able to have access to screening, early diagnosis, and treatment to prevent and delay end-stage kidney disease. And as you saw from that brief cartoon I showed you of where we are in South Africa in the amount of renal replacement therapy we are providing in the form of dialysis and transplant, we need to address the challenges that we are facing, that our numbers on treatment are extremely low. And one needs to provide supportive symptomatic care to patients throughout the continuum. And then, as you see, while this talk is on chronic kidney disease, one could equally apply it to all other forms of chronic, non-communicable chronic disease. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Prof. A very rounded presentation will take us through the pathogenesis and show us where we are in terms of kidney treatment, and also what we should be doing also at clinic level. It's quite helpful, and I think it touches on all areas of the health discipline and also all healthcare workers. And I think for some of us, when you emphasize, last week we're told you know, exercise for 30 minutes, and you're saying it again today, exercise for 30 minutes every day, which is something that we hardly do. Because I think the whole focus was to more on prevention. Thank you very much. Sure, there's a question here already. Kasim Ishradar, please, if you can mute yourself. There's a first question here. Maybe if you stop sharing, I don't know, because it still shows there. A 58-year-old male was admitted.
Okay, thank you. I've done that. Yeah, I thought
Yeah, no, that's fine. Yes, thank you very much. That's 58-year-old from Dr. Mukari, and Mukari wants to know if 58-year-old male was admitted to hospital with a GFR of 3. He was subsequently put on dialysis, and intravenous fistula was created. He responded well to dialysis, and upon discharge from hospital 4 weeks later, his renal function normalized. His GFR was 90. A monthly renal function to date are normal. Should he keep the AV fistula or remove it? You're muted. You're still muted.
Yes, can you hear me now? So I assume the patient had kidney failure at that stage and was being dialyzed, is that correct?
Yeah.
So if the patient had kidney failure and needed dialysis and recovered to a GFR of over 90, then what this means is that the patient had acute kidney failure, and therefore one needs to follow the patient up at 3 months to see if the kidney function has normalized at 3 months. So if it's normalized at 3 months, then you'd say this was acute kidney injury. But if the patient has some evidence of kidney dysfunction at that stage, like proteinuria or hematuria, one calls this acute kidney disease, and one might need to do more intensive tests. If things don't settle, one might want to biopsy this patient, because the patient might have had an acute on chronic condition, for instance, or they have residual kidney damage structurally, which hasn't completely reversed. So it's these patients who have this entity called acute kidney disease that could progress in the future. So the fact that the person's become dialysis independent at that point does not mean that all is rosy, which we used to think. So one needs to follow these patients up initially 3 monthly and then perhaps annually to make sure that their kidney function remains normal. And if they have proteinuria or hypertension or diabetes, then these need to be addressed very rigorously.
Yeah. The follow-up question is, should they keep the AV fistula or remove it? Because they're doing it for acute renal dialysis at the time.
Yeah. Well, I wouldn't remove it immediately in this sort of patient. I would watch this patient for 3 to 6 months, and depending on his situation at that stage, one would reverse it.
Okay. No, I think it's clear.
Same as a transplant, when we transplant a patient and the transplant's working very well, we leave things in place for about 3 months, and then at 3 months we reverse the fistula, or if they've got a peritoneal dialysis catheter, we'd remove it at that point.
Okay. So my network is a bit unstable. As I said, I've got a low bandwidth. I hope you can hear me. Dr. Lambert wants to know, in treatment for hypertension, the B blockers and the calcium blockers, have they any real protein protection, renal protection, but also it's a very great presentation?
There's been lots of debate on that because everybody had this sort of enthusiasm and passion to use ACE inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers. And no doubt they have a place, but one finds that certain populations don't do so well with these, especially the elderly. And it's been shown in some studies that people on calcium channel blockers have done very well, and it's been renal protective, though the mechanism, it doesn't affect the renin angiotensin system. So certainly I think the important thing for me is that when someone has hypertension and you're seeing the person regularly, depending on the age and the situation, it's important to individualize treatment. Some people would do very well with a beta blocker, whereas if it's an athlete, you wouldn't want to give them a beta blocker. You try and use an ACE inhibitor in a younger person. An older person, you might want to use a calcium channel blocker and a low-dose diuretic. So I think one needs to individualize treatment to your patient population. And the important thing is to treat to target and to achieve your blood pressure targets.
Okay. Is it always a combination therapy that one should be doing at all times, or one should, as you say, individualize, or isn't it? Yeah.
I think combination treatment's important, and the mass bulk of the people can get by on combination treatment. But sometimes in these combinations, one component of the combination may be problematic. For instance, when you have an indapamide combination, nowadays with the lower dose indapamide, it's less of a problem. But when there's a regular dose indapamide combination, we found that we're dealing with a whole lot of people with hypokalemia. And the company says, no, indapamide's not supposed to cause hypokalemia. But in the practical sense, you found that it worked like your thiazide diuretic and cause hypokalemia. So the idea now is to have low dose combinations, and then that's safe. So I also think that the pill burden is important. So while one wants to use combination treatment to try and make sure that people have fewer pills to take, but if that is not working for individuals, then one should have the opportunity to to sort of mix and match and do what's correct. It's just like using HIV agents for people with HIV kidney disease. We know that some agents, you cannot use them in people with a lower GFR, and especially the tenofovir products if the GFR is less than 50. One would have to then reduce the dose, and you may not be able to do that, and therefore single agents are easier to use then.
Okay. Okay, colleagues, anyone else who's got a question? I see there are no further questions. It was so clear that people, last week when someone was saying, no, we're not asking questions because everything was so clear. I hope, but I think maybe there are other colleagues who've got questions. There are people who have seen patients, problematic patients, or maybe someone who's in the GP practice wants to ask questions about what they are seeing. There are physicians amongst us here also, and other colleagues who are in your field. There's a question here now. What about the statin use? The priority wants to know.
Yes, low-dose statins, as I mentioned, should be part of the treatment. And obviously, one needs to be aware that sometimes patients may have muscle problems because of statins. And anyway, you are the people who should be really there facing handling the epidemic of chronic kidney disease, because if we can impact and treat to target for diabetes, hypertension, HIV, etc., then we can reduce the burden of end-stage kidney disease and cardiac disease and cerebral vascular disease.
Can I move it to HIV, Dr. Malin Osuno? In HIV patients being treated with tenofovir and dolutegravir, how can one distinguish whether the elevated creatinine is due to the tenofovir or the dolutegravir?
That's a very good question. One of the important things, if you look at HIV guidelines, they do recommend that everybody should have, testing for kidney function, where serum creatinine needs to be done, and dipsticks to make sure they don't have proteinuria. So that's in the ideal world. And even while these are in the HIV clinicians' guidelines, it doesn't always happen. So when you find a patient arriving with kidney disease, you're not sure whether it's due to HIV or whether it's due to tenofovir. Some clues in it would be if there's obvious evidence of tubular dysfunction. You know, whereas HIV kidney disease per se would cause proteinuria and elevated serum creatinine. Whereas with tenofovir, you might find phosphaturia, minor aciduria, glycosuria. So those things would help to distinguish. But in practical terms, what often happens is that you stop the tenofovir and see if the patient improves, and then you might even go ahead and biopsy the patient. So we've done a lot of biopsies because nobody knew what the kidney function was, and there was no evidence of, you know, predominantly tubular dysfunction. And okay. Also the other thing to say is that most of the forms of HIV kidney disease present very similarly, with just proteinuria and elevated serum creatinine. So you can't really say what type of kidney disease they have. Some people say, does it matter? Do you need to know? I think it's important to know, because you want to prognosticate, because patients want to know what to expect. And if you have advanced HIV-associated nephropathy, both you and the patient should know that even though you're giving them antiretroviral therapy, inevitably, at some stage, this person would need renal replacement therapy. Whereas if they've got other sort of immune forms of glomerular disease, their progression could be slower. And you might use, besides using antiretroviral therapy, in these patients, you might use corticosteroids or immunosuppressive agents in an effort to dampen down the glomerular disease.
Okay. Okay, thanks. Thanks for that. But I think we've gained quite a lot of information and given us tools on how to, because the main purpose was to say prevent kidney disease and what can we do. as you know, clinicians and even other healthcare workers. And I like the idea that you also mentioned that there's also task sharing or task shifting that you spoke about. The nurses could also be assisted or be empowered, and the clinical associates. And I think that's a category of health professionals that we seem not to be utilizing effectively.
There's another category, right, that I didn't mention. There was a project in South India, in rural South India, where they had a lot of school leavers hanging around, like we have, you know, just hanging about, no jobs, not doing anything. I think we can engage them quite at a very cost-effective way, train them to take blood pressures, call on people in rural areas, people who struggle to get to clinics. So they were given a bicycle. That was the mode of transport in India. So they had a bicycle, automated blood pressure machine, a glucometer, and they were given simple drugs to dispense. And they went and followed up patients regularly. And when one looked at the long-term outcome of the study, they actually did really well. If you look at the general rate of progression of kidney disease, I mean, they obviously picked up people here because, you know, people were getting care in their homes. It was actually a very effective way to do it. And it's something that we could easily do in South Africa, employ some of our unemployed youth, don't you think?
Yeah, I think so. I think something like the robots where they spoke about the word-based, I think, forgotten what the full name, but kind of healthcare workers, community healthcare workers. That's something that we should be considering. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. It's been a quite an invigorating discussion, and also quite, we spoke earlier about whether sharing the slides, because they would ask me, but generally that question comes up that will be, we are able to share the slides for those who are, you know, we've got YouTube to look at, but also some colleagues would love to share the slides. So you.
Yes. So what I'll do, Ray, I'll have a very quick look now and I'll send you a message. If there's a problem with one or two slides, I'll be happy if you could convert it to PDF format and then you can share it.
Okay, that's fine. We'll do that.
Thank you.
Yeah, we've got Paul Vareva in our audience.
Oh, do we? Hi, Joe. How are you?
I'm going to ask him to just. He when I said I'm in trouble, I'm not able to find a speaker. He said no, go to Professor Naika, and I sort of quickly checked and I said no, let me call her quickly, and then here you are. I want to say thanks to him for helping us to get you. So you just do the close. He is with us now. It is committee.
I think you had one advantage, Ray. Joe is one of these people I've never been able to say no to, and he knows it. You know, my years. That's
And I also remember you in the days when I was doing my studies and about Supermani case. And I think for me, I always think about you. When I think about you, I think about the Supermani case. It's something that is etched in the history of this country in the Constitutional Court. Mm. And thanks for that guidance you've given us.
Thank you.
So, Professor, you can just say a few words as we close.
Sarala, good evening, and thank you very much for really a very comprehensive and an outstanding presentation on a very, very important topic. And this topic is very important, as you know, it's because a significant number of people will not get end-stage renal failure therapy. Dialysis in the public sector will not be or does not cater for all the people that require it. So clearly, what you've mentioned, all that would delay the onset. And in fact, it's an ethical responsibility that we should, in fact, slow down the progression of renal disease rather than letting it gallop away towards stage 5 kidney disease. Now, the other thing is that it's I regard it as a privilege that you have addressed us this evening. And it's a privilege because you, Sarella, are not only an outstanding nephrologist or recognized as one of the great nephrologists in South Africa, but you also have a great reputation at an international level. And your recent trip to India and all that, I'm sure you did quite a few talks. And you've been doing talks all over Africa and other parts of the world. So it is a privilege to have you coming over here or Zooming through Zoom to make a presentation. It's not often we get an academic of your caliber. And I thought I'll just make one additional point. Now this is, I'm just going to show off a bit. I was just going through the NEJM this morning. And in the NEJM, they mention the SGLT2, medication. And they found, they looked at it, and in addition to slowing down the progression of kidney disease, it also decreased the mortality. And this is something you mentioned in your talk, that people with kidney disease often have associated cardiovascular disease. So maybe this SGLT2 may have an additional benefit in protecting us against mortality from cardiovascular disease or developing cardiovascular disease. And so thank you very much for your effort. And I know that you do get stressed every time you have to talk, but it doesn't matter to you. You will go ahead and do it. So thank you for that. And also, and it's from clinics and all the audience that we have here. On behalf of all of them, we thank you. And also, I usually forget to thank Ray Billa, because he's been chairing this and keeping this going and always having to find that. So thank you, Ray, for keeping this whole program going.
Thanks, Prof.
And good night, everyone.
Yeah, no, thanks a lot. And also marketing team, that I work with a marvelous team that marketing to help us. Once I get a speaker, they do the job to get everything organized for getting this program running and also getting CPD points. And thanks a lot, colleagues, and have a good evening. Thanks a lot, Prof. Maika, and please.
Thank you, and thank you, Joe, for your very kind words.
Thanks a lot, sir. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
Bye-bye.
Bye.